Morning everyone, and welcome back to the Runpreneur vlog, where we discuss all things entrepreneurship and running. It is an extremely cold morning. I think the feels like temperature is minus 10 today, so it's brutally cold. Not great to run in, if I'm being brutally honest with you. And it's Thursday Tales today, where we talk about past experiences in business. And today's topic is about property lease options. So as always, if you like this episode, please give it a like and a subscribe, and let's get started. So, property lease options. Okay, I've done maybe 7 or so of these over the years, and I've also sold some of my properties via lease option as well. So I've been on both sides of the coin here. So first and foremost, I'll try to explain what a property lease option is. It's relatively complicated, but it doesn't have to be. Ultimately, it's when you take control of a property for a period of time and you have the right, but not the obligation, to buy it at some point in the future. So what we mean by that, it's like a restriction on the property. You're controlling it, the vendor can't sell it, you've agreed a sale price at a fixed point in the future, or any point up to that fixed point in the future. And for the duration of the lease, you'll be servicing all the costs associated with the property. So you think, well, why would you want to do this? And why would anybody want to offer this to you? Well, that's a good question. But first and foremost, it's for the buyer. It means you can take control of properties and rent them out and cash flow them without having to put your 25% deposit in that you'd normally have to if you were buying it. You can let the property appreciate in value over the course of the term that you control it before you buy it. And why would a vendor agree to this? Is, well, generally speaking, it's normally really useful in negative equity cases or for extremely motivated sellers in a depressed market. So you have to be careful, and you don't want to be exploit the situation here. But ultimately, it's a really useful, powerful tool, and I know it's quite big in the commercial sense. I mean, it's more kind of commonly used in the commercial sense than it is in the residential. But my experience of using lease options are in residential, in simple properties. Okay, so things you need to kind of consider when you do them. I mean, I've got some that I've still got lease options in place. I haven't executed them yet. I've got some that are being sold with the lease option still in place, and we're waiting to sell. And I've had some that, you know what, when times were tough, I had to let them go. And I had that flexibility to be able to do that. It's pure and simply because the way the legal contract was, it's the right but not the obligation. Now, on the flip side, people talk about instalment contracts or exchanges with delayed completion. Well, you've actually exchanged contracts on those. So that's the big differential between a lease option and an instalment contract or exchange with delayed completion. You've actually exchanged contracts, so you're legally obliged to buy that property. Okay, so from a vendor's perspective, they might want to push you down that route as opposed to a lease option. But lease options are super flexible and a really, really valuable tool in somebody in property who's going to be a problem solver for kind of motivated sellers. So the kind of way it's broken down is you have to pay an option fee or an option consideration to set these documents up. But generally speaking, you'd normally pay £1. That seems to be the going rate. You can set that whatever you want. And the first thing to state here is it's almost like a blank canvas. There are some elements of the contracts that have to be in place, like the option consideration, the term, you know, the payments, the monthly payments you're making, you know, the fixed fee in the future. All these things kind of need to be in place. But other than that, it's a blank canvas. So you can negotiate all sorts of crazy heads of terms. So for the really creative people, you can structure some amazing agreements. And I mean, Donald Trump, I don't like talking about him because there's so much negative press about him, but from a business perspective, he built a lot of his empire by controlling assets, not acquiring them. And he was controlling them by using some form of lease option agreement. So he's it just goes to show you can build £1 billion empires and stuff by using contracts like this. And you know what? The people are saying, well, there's no value. Well, there is, because for the fee that the price that he fixes things for and the appreciation over the course of the time, you're building equity in the contract, which is a saleable asset, because you can sell options as well. So they are really cool tools when you get to use them. I've not used them enough because they're quite difficult to find vendors suitable for them. You have to be careful to stay on the right side of an ethical approach, because you are dealing with people's livelihoods here. So it's something I've never really pushed. It was primarily my business partner, ex-business partner at the time, who was opening a lot of these doors. And it was only when I came across somebody who almost came to me that I would recommend a lease option if I couldn't find an alternative solution to kind of help them. And so I do have a bit of, I'm not an expert in this, but I do have a fair amount of experience for both sides. So an option, a lease option is made up of three contracts ultimately. You've got the option agreement, which is where you're setting the price for the future, the term, when you're going to buy it, etc. You're going to have the management agreement, which is the lease of you controlling the property. You'll have a power of attorney, which is giving you legally binding, you know, a decision-making ability on that property. And they're the three different contracts ultimately. There is a fourth one, I think it's called an irrevocable agreement of some kind. But that's generally to do with securing equity on mortgage lenders, etc. A bit more complicated. I've never really used it. It's more relevant when you're kind of selling portfolios on option agreement or lease option agreement. So my experience with them is, like I say, I've had about seven, I think, off the top of my head that I've taken on, and I've sold maybe five via a lease option or still in play. Several of these are still in play. There's a couple that have fallen out of bed. So what would I recommend to people? Well, first and foremost, it is quite an advanced strategy, and you do need to understand or have a basis or an understanding of property investment before you engage in these things, because they're notoriously difficult to explain to a vendor. Most of the time the vendors won't have any experience in kind of property investing, and they'll think it's dodgy. It's not dodgy, it's all done through conveyancing, but you'd need a specific conveyancer or solicitor who's experienced in this. I mean, lease options are massive in the States. They've been bigger and bigger over in the UK the past 5 or 6 years, but they're still not kind of common knowledge, whereas they are in like Australia and the States, they're much more common. So you need to find a solicitor who's experienced in drawing up the contracts. But ultimately, it's sit down with the vendor and work out what they need. Look at the numbers, look at what you need, and you're trying, it's negotiation ultimately. I mean, you can set them, I'm not sure if there's a restriction on how long the term can be. More often than not, the term is generally 7 years. 5 to 7 years is relatively common, which gives the owner enough time, or the lease option purchaser the time to, for the property to go up in value, to make it viable for them to purchase it. I mean, a perfect strategy would be properties in negative equity. You want to hold it until it goes up in value significantly, so that you can almost buy it and refinance your money back out. So it's like a no money down deal. That would be a perfect example of how someone would use them. But you'll often find lease options can be in kind of depressed areas as well, where capital growth is quite restricted. So you need to really scrutinise the deal. But the beauty of them is you do have an out. But what I would say is never, ever go into one of these agreements with the view that you're not going to execute. Because I've been through the process of when, you know, I was going through some really tough financial times. I had to pull out of a couple of my lease option deals. And the kind of pain that put the vendor under, who wasn't expecting it, the vendor thought the property was sold, was something that is just deeply, yeah, deeply regretted. But I was in survival mode at the time, so I had no alternative. But ultimately, I think the vendors have sorted it out. Well, in fact, I know they have. So it all ended okay. But it wasn't a very pleasant experience. So you always want to go in with the intention to kind of complete on them, pure and simply because, you know, you're playing with people's livelihoods, taking control of their assets and with the intention to buy. But if you pull out and they've based their future and moving on in their life on the basis that property's selling at that price, then it's pretty, can be pretty catastrophic to their to their circumstances, so please bear that in mind. But you know, with the leases, like you say, you're generally going to be paying, you know, you can even do creative stuff, like you're generally be paying at least the mortgage payments. It's like babysitting the mortgage. You don't have to get new mortgage or anything. Technically, the mortgage lender should be engaged, but the power of attorney document gives you the power to kind of have those negotiations to ensure that they're aware that you kind of, there's somebody else paying the mortgage now. But quite often in these situations, the, you know, you're normally dealing with these cases where there's a mortgage arrears, etc. So there might be an agreement where you have to clear mortgage arrears. You know, it's on a case-by-case basis, really. You know, you have to kind of go dive deep. But what you can do is you can explain it to a vendor as in you're babysitting their mortgage. That's quite an easy way for them to understand. And but what you can also do is you could be paying more than the mortgage, which go towards them, which you can have contractually written up, which is going towards a deposit. So you could even set it up though that come the time you apply it, the 25% deposit or whatever deposit's going in has been covered. So you can see kind of the flexibility here. So this is probably a really waffly explanation of what a lease option is and how it works. But I want to talk to you about it today because it is a really powerful tool. It's something that I haven't done for years. Probably 4 years is the last time I did one. And probably 7 years ago since I did my first one. So I haven't done them, hasn't been an aggressive strategy, but I know people that have made fortunes from doing it. It was just a strategy that I found there was too many nuances. It was often tricky and I didn't like the responsibility of having a lot of kind of people's livelihoods on my shoulders, you know, certainly at the time, certainly when I was going through some tough times, which is why I haven't perhaps explored it any further. But that's not to say now that if an opportunity presented itself, that I wouldn't explore the usage of a lease option again, because it's a really powerful tool, especially if you're building a property portfolio and you cannot raise finance, because generally property is very cyclical. You raise money, you then have a period where you're fixed into kind of mortgage terms before you can pull more money out. If you want to keep growing during the time where you can't raise any more money, no money down strategies or low money down strategies like lease options, rent to rent, instalment contracts, things like this are really, really valuable. So if I was summarizing a lease option, it is the right but not the obligation to buy a property. So the one thing I didn't say as well is generally you'd register a restriction on the property to protect. I think it's an RX one, but I can't remember the legal form. I think it's a restriction on a property basically, which says you have got an interest in that property and that it cannot be sold without you removing your restriction. I think it's an RX one. Someone will correct me, I'm sure. But it's a registered restriction on the property. That's all part of the deal, which means that the vendor can't sell it from under your feet to kind of safeguard your kind of position. But yeah, if I was going to summarise, it's the right but not the obligation to buy a property. It's made up of three contracts. It's an option contract, which is where you have an option fee, an option term, a monthly payment or payment terms, whatever you're kind of doing, and a fixed price at some point in the future. You have a management agreement, which is the lease, which is the management terms and conditions, what you can and cannot do with the property. And you have a power of attorney, which gives you legally binding control over the asset in every capacity. So they're the kind of three documents. You would need a specialist conveyancer who's experienced with this to draw up those contracts in a legally binding way and register the restriction on the property. And it generally helps motivated sellers who are in negative equity. You have an ability to structure some kind of deal where you can cover their mortgage payments so they're not going to lose the house, or if they're in financial disarray, you can structure it in a way that they can move on with their lives without this massive financial ball and chain around their necks. And that if you're an experienced property investor, you can often, you know, do a strategy like a rent to rent or two squared or service accommodation or whatever, a higher cash flow performing strategy, or even single lets, or to find a tenant buyer is another one. You can put a tenant buyer in there who's paying it, giving you an income, plus paying towards the deposit for when they execute on the option. That's a sandwich option contract, but that's going really kind of quite complex, so I'm not going to go into that right now. But hopefully that's helpful. Like I say, I'm just trying to, you know, I've had seven properties that I've sold, five properties, sorry, I've sold through a lease option. And the reason I did that was pure and simply because they were miles away around the country. I'd notoriously struggled with voids from poor letting agencies, so they were just costing me money every month. So I found an investor who was more locally based towards those properties, who wanted to take them, he's gone in and done some renovation works, which was great for me because he's put investment into them, so inevitably that's more likely he's going to execute on those options. And if he doesn't, I've had renovated properties that he's tenanted and got cash flowing that I'll get back. But I think he will complete on them. And ultimately, it means that I haven't had to worry. I've had no more loss-making elements attached with those properties for the last almost 7 years now. So that's from a kind of vendor's perspective. That's why it worked for me. But you have to kind of dive deep on people's reasons and then draw heads of terms together, which works for both parties. So that's pretty much it for me today. Hope that's been useful. If you've got any questions on this, drop me a question or a comment and I'll respond to everyone. If it's a bigger question, I'll do a separate vlog episode and tag you in. If this is irrelevant information to you, just unfollow me. It'll stop cluttering up your social feeds. You don't have to unfriend, just unfollowing will stop the content appearing on your news feeds, which is absolutely fine. But before you do that, do check out my YouTube channel, Rompreneur, where I do a different topic on every day of the week. So just because today's is irrelevant, it may be that tomorrow or the day after is very relevant to you. So do check that out, and it's all organised nice and neatly by topic and playlist. Check out the link on my bio. I'm starting to put free resources out there now. First one being my 70-step process for how I repurpose my content across all platforms. So if you want to know how to do that more effectively, please check out that checklist. It'll hopefully help you in some capacity. And finally, the Rompreneur blog was set up to help entrepreneurs and business owners overcome the emotions of stress, overwhelm, and anxiety by using exercise, or in my case, running, as a release mechanism or release valve to kind of relieve the daily, weekly pressures in the form of stress that, if not controlled, build up over the course of time and, you know, build up so much, like it's like pressure in a pipe, that the stress and overwhelm builds up and boom, something breaks. And it's usually the entrepreneur has a breakdown or the business has a breakdown. Either or can be terminal to the likelihood of that business lasting at the time. Now, it can be the difference between success and failure, how well entrepreneurs and business owners deal with these emotions, or anybody in life, because we all get them. And, you know, it's no coincidence that ever since I've been doing running every day for the last 8 months or so, and vlogging, it's my release mechanism. And, you know, as a result, I've made more progress in the last 8 months than I have in the previous 4 years. So there's no coincidence there. I finally feel in control. I don't feel like I've got huge overwhelm. I've got clarity on where I'm going. And if you don't have that release, the pressure builds up and then the overwhelm sets in, where you get blinded. You can't see what's going on. You just bury your head in the sand. It turns into anxiety. You panic. And then all sorts of stuff goes horribly wrong. And I've been there. I've lost multiple businesses because of this. I've lost multiple business partners because of it. And I've almost been bankrupt because of it. So, and I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. So it's a horrible, horrible place. So, which is why, you know, my pledge to you is that if you are somebody who's going through this, just reach out, drop me a message, and we'll jump on a call. There's no catch here, I'm not selling you anything at all. I'll just give you some steps that I've kind of followed that have helped me massively, that hopefully will help you, and we'll try and get you back on the right path. And so many have already taken me up on this offer, and I know we've made a massively positive impact on their lives and their business's life. And I always said that if this vlog just helps one entrepreneur, saves one business, it's been 1,000,000% worthwhile. So, on that basis, all that's left to say is that if you like this episode, please give it a like, comment, and subscribe. If you want to see more similar content, please check out the playlist link in the YouTube channel. And as always, I'll end with stay positive, stay happy, and I'll see you tomorrow. Bye.